Hello everyone, welcome to Sam Science View channel. In today's video, we are going to listen science behind golf game. Before getting into the video, please do watch the entire video and do support and subscribe to my channel. Now let's get into the video. The physics of golf is a detailed subject. It involves forces and aerodynamics occurring during the hitting of the ball, during its flight through the air, during the run of the ball after landing, and during the putt. Golfers often put much effort into perfecting their golf game. This effort can yield additional benefit if combined with an understanding of the physics involved. Here, the main physics behind golf is to be discussed one by one. First, the golf swing. Its physics is deceptively more complicated than one might imagine. At first glance, it might appear as simple as swinging a club and hitting the ball. But in fact, there is quite a bit more to it. There is the importance of technique, obviously, but there is also some interesting physics that goes into making the perfect golf shot. There are two main components that go into golf swing physics. Both these will result in the best possible shot. First, good swinging speed of the arms and shoulders, and second, uncocking the wrist at the right moment so that the club connects squarely with the ball. Uncocking the wrists means letting the wrists rotate freely while still holding on to the club. The importance of the first point is fairly obvious. You must generate good swing speed to hit the ball hard enough so that it goes far. The second point is not as obvious. To understand the physics of a golf swing, one must consider the mechanics of rotational motion. When an object travels around in a circle, it moves outwards if unconstrained. To visualize this, imagine yourself sitting in a car that makes a sharp left turn. If you are not wearing your seat belt, you will go sliding across the seat towards the right due to the effects of centripetal acceleration. Similarly, by uncocking your wrists during the golf swing, the club will move radially outward since it's not restrained. This is unlike, say, baseball, where the batter drives the bat through its arc using raw muscle power. A baseball player relies on strong wrists and forearms to get a solid hit. His hands are active. This is unlike golf, where the player's hands are passive since they exert no twisting force on the club. This probably gives you some idea why baseball players have such beefy forearms and wrists. They need the strength to power the bat through the swing. Uncocking the wrist allows the golf club to straighten out and in the process gain additional speed, which translates into a harder hit than if the golf club were held rigid, meaning the wrists are not allowed to rotate during the swing. In the picture, you can see the physics in action. At the top part of the swing, the golf club remains at a fixed angle relative to his arm since his wrists are cocked. But in the bottom part of the swing, the golf club begins to release and angle between it and his arms begin to rapidly increase since his wrists are now uncocked and the club moves radially outwards as a result. At the bottom of the swing, the golf club is almost perfectly parallel to his arms. This is where contact is made with the ball. Part of the physics of a golf swing from the point of view of golfer means finding the release, that is wrist uncocking point, so that at the bottom position where the player's hands are directly above the ball, the golf club is in the vertical position parallel to his arms. This will maximize the speed of the club head upon impact and results in the farthest hit. Once the player knows the approximate point in the swing where he can uncock his wrist, he just has to practice it over and over until it becomes a second nature. And prior to this release point, he just has to keep his wrist cocked, meaning maintain his grip in a fixed position so that the club maintains a constant angle with his arms. Once he releases his wrists, the physics takes care of the rest, and the club will move radially outwards due to the effect of centripetal acceleration. Now we will see the sweet spot present in the golf club. When the golf club head impacts the golf ball, it is ideal for the line of action of the impact force to pass through the center of mass of the club head. In this picture, we can see the center of mass of the club head depicted by a red dot and the point of impact depicted by a blue dot are shown. The center of mass of the club head is actually a tiny point which is much smaller than the red dot, whose size is greatly exaggerated for its clarity. If the line of action of the impact force generated at the blue dot location is overly offset from the center of mass of the club head, then we have an overly eccentric impact. As a result, the club head will excessively rotate, twist, and in addition, excessive club vibration will result. It is a physics property of rigid bodies that eccentric forces whose line of action is offset from their center of mass create a torque which causes the body to rotate, which we discussed in the previous video. An overly eccentric impact can cause the ball trajectory to deviate from its intended path due to club head twist. And in addition, the ball does not travel as far due to energy loss from the club vibration. The center of mass point of the club head projected onto the club head face in the direction that is perpendicular to the face is commonly referred to as the sweet spot. If the line of action of the impact force passes through the club head center of mass, then club head twist is eliminated and vibration is minimized. But in more practical terms, which a golfer would find useful, there is perhaps an area on the club head face roughly a quarter inch wide that contains sweet spot in which impact is ideal. Impact inside this area will result in minimal club head twisting and minimal club vibration. The impact itself is a very violent event. It lasts roughly 0.0005 seconds and the force of impact can be up to 2000 pounds. One interesting fact is that during impact, the force exerted on the club head by the shaft is negligible compared to the impact force between club head and ball. Hence, during impact, the club head can be treated as a free body. This is a very useful simplification when performing a dynamic analysis of the club head during impact. Now we will discuss optimal loft angle of golf club head. It is an interesting physics problem to determine the optimal loft angle of a golf club head in order to maximize the driving distance. The loft angle is the angle between the club head face and the vertical plane and the driving distance, which is the distance the ball travels through the air plus the distance it travels after it lands. This picture shows the loft angle. This loft angle affects the ball launch angle, the launch speed and the rate of backspin of the ball. This in turn affects the distance the ball travels through the air and the distance the ball travels after it lands, which is nothing but the driving distance. This is what we wish to maximize based on the loft angle. This problem is tackled in the following paper. The greater the club head speed, the lower the optimal dynamic loft angle. The dynamic loft angle is the loft angle of the club face during impact. The dynamic loft angle in general is not equal to the club face loft angle when the club head is at rest on the ground. This is the angle which is typically specified on the golf club. The difference between the two angles is due to the flexing of the golf club shaft during impact. Initially, at the point at the top of the swing, the shaft bends back, causing the club head to lag behind. This is due to the inertia of the club head. However, at some point during the swing, the club head catches up, but the shaft, continuing to flex, begins to flex forward. As a result, when impact occurs, the club head is turned several degrees ahead of the position it would have had if the shaft had not flexed. The dynamic loft angle will generally be several degrees greater than the loft angle when the club head is at rest on the ground. For initial club head speeds of 35, 45 and 55 meters per second, the optimal dynamic loft angles are 16.5 degree, 13.1 degree and 10.7 degree respectively. The dependence of the optimal loft angles on club head speed agrees in general with current practices in golf. According to simulation results, these initial club head speeds corresponds to a maximum driving distance of 155 meters, 210 meters and 255 meters respectively. Now let's see the aerodynamics of ball flight. The dimples on a golf ball create a thin, turbulent boundary layer of air over the ball surface. This reduces air resistance, which results in ball traveling a farther distance than a smooth ball would. Such a distance improvement is desirable for making a shot as long as possible. The picture shows the flow of air over a dimpled golf ball. The air flow over the ball follows smooth streamlines until some point beyond the halfway distance at which the turbulent boundary layer separates and turbulent eddies form inside a resulting wake region. This wake region has low pressure, which causes the greater pressure in front of the ball to exert a net pressure force opposite the direction of motion of the ball, known as drag, which we discussed in the previous video. Turbulent flow induced by the dimples reduces the size of this low pressure wake region from that of a smooth ball. This results in a lower net pressure force, which results in less drag than with a smooth ball. A smooth ball with no dimples would cause the boundary layer to separate sooner, resulting in a larger wake region, and hence more drag would result. The number of dimples on a typical golf ball ranges from 250 to 450. Different manufacturers have different theories on the ideal number of dimples, the ideal depth of the dimples, and the ideal placement patterns of the dimples. In fact, all these attributes affect the ball's overall aerodynamic qualities during flight. This picture shows the airflow over the rotating golf ball, which experiences an upward lift force F as a result of the rotation. The ball typically rotates at several thousand RPM rotations per minute. This rotation is a result of the friction between club head face and ball, which causes the ball to roll up the lofted club head face during impact and gain backspin as a result. The upward force is caused by the Magnus effect, which we discussed in two videos before in football free kick, which causes the ball to fly higher and remain airborne longer. Hence, it flies farther than it would than if there were no rotation. This, in combination with lower air drag due to the ball dimples, results in an extra long shot. In addition to greatly reducing air drag, dimples also greatly enhance the Magnus effect, resulting in a great improvement in hitting distance. For example, a dimpled ball can be driven 250 meters by a skilled golfer as opposed to only 100 meters or so for a smooth ball without dimples. Similarly, the air flow over the rotating ball follows smooth streamlines until some point behind the halfway distance at which the turbulent boundary layer separates and turbulent eddies form inside a resulting wake region. If the wake region is shifted down from before for a non-rotating ball, the aerodynamic forces acting on the ball are thus altered. The phenomenon behind this is called the Magnus effect. Now, the picture below, this picture illustrates the Magnus effect for a rotating ball. As the ball spins, the friction between the ball and air causes the air to react to the direction of spin of the ball. As the ball undergoes backspin, shown as a clockwise rotation in this picture, it causes the velocity of the air around the bottom half of the ball to become less than the air velocity around the top half of the ball. This is because the tangential velocity of the ball in the bottom half acts in the opposite direction to the airflow, and the tangential velocity of the ball in the top half acts in the same direction as the airflow. The airflow in this picture is in the rightward direction relative to the ball. Since the resultant airspeed around the bottom half of the ball is less than the airspeed around the top half of the ball, the pressure is greater on the bottom of the ball. This causes a net upward force F to act on the ball. This is due to the Bernoulli's principle, which states that when air velocity decreases, air pressure increases and vice versa. And lastly, the putting, which is the gentle final shot or set of shoots for hitting the ball into the hole. If the ground in the direction of the shoot is perfectly flat, perfectly uphill or perfectly downhill, then hitting the ball into the hole is simply a matter of hitting it along a straight line directly into the hole. However, sometimes the ground is sloped such that ball trajectory cannot be a straight line in order to enter the hole. In this instance, hitting the ball into the hole is a much more complicated matter. The ball must follow a precise curved path in order to enter the hole. This we can see in this picture. The ball must roll along a curved trajectory before it can enter the hole. Whether the ball must curve left or right depends on which way the ground slope is tilted. It is evident that such a shot takes a lot of practice to master. Modeling the mathematics of the ball trajectory on sloped ground is a complex task requiring knowledge of the ground topology in order to properly account for the gravity force acting on the ball as it rolls along and the dynamics of the grass-ball interaction as the ball rolls along. This is quite complicated, and such an analysis will likely be of little benefit to the golfer, since this is primarily a learned skill based on muscle memory, coordination, and human judgment. So that's it for today's video about science behind golf. Do like, comment, share, and do subscribe to my channel. Meet you in the next Science Behind series. Until then, take care. Goodbye from Sam.